December 16th, 1977, Saturday Night Fever hit theaters and instantly became a cultural phenomenon.
Are you as good in bed as you are on that dance floor?
Thanks to the sex appeal of John Travolta.
John's fans were shaking this trailer.
All of Brooklyn, it seemed, had come out to see him.
It was like 10,000 kids.
The infectious dance grooves of the Bee Gees.
When we first heard the music, we were just absolutely blown away.
One of the great albums of all time.
And a storyline of disenfranchised youth that connected with audiences everywhere.
You're a cliche. You're nowhere on your way to no place.
It's just one of those movies that people related to.
Saturday Night Fever would go on to help create a look and attitude that would define the 70s. But this pop culture juggernaut started out as a throwaway in a three-picture deal.
Grease, that was the guaranteed hit.
Featuring a TV actor no one thought would be a star.
Who's gonna pay any attention to John Travolta?
And powered by a music act that had hit the skids.
We were pretty much done for. We couldn't get arrested.
Production problems dogged the film for months.
There was a revolving door of writers, and we had no distributor.
And what is with you, huh?
Tempers flared during the demanding shoot schedule.
John turned around and said, I'll be in my trailer.
I had a fit. I cried at the first showing.
And at times, the film's novice cast and crew feared the worst.
I saw the rough cut and freaked out.
We all said, well, you know, this sucks.
What have I gotten myself into?
But as Fever came together, its makers began to realize they had something special on their hands.
This is a winner. I mean, this is incredible.
Over 30 years later, Saturday Night Fever still captivates audiences.
It's a movie that really speaks to people. It's a movie that has something to say.
Ain't nobody gonna give you a chance.
Nobody gives you nothing, Joey.
You know the lines.
He hits my hair.
Didn't dig it.
I knew that you could.
You know the music. But you don't know the inside story.
The good news is you've been nominated for an Academy Award. The bad news is you're fired.
Saturday Night Fever took the world by storm in 1977.
Now we have Stephanie Mangano and Tony Manero.
It was making $1 million a day for months and months and months.
Perhaps no other film of the 1970s represents the styles, attitudes.
You know how many times somebody told me I was good in my life?
And personalities of the decade.
You sure as never did.
It's a movie about a culture. You know, it's kind of a social phenomenon that was going on in Brooklyn in the 70s.
If an iconic performance and star-making dance sequences weren't enough to make the film a must-see event, the best-selling soundtrack certainly sealed the deal.
That was how I knew something unusual was going on. There were that many hits in a row in the film.
Combined with the music, Fever's dynamic dance scenes, complete with glowing disco balls, lighted dance floors, and choreographed line dances, captivated audiences.
There isn't one moment where Travolta's dancing that I'm not totally smitten by the movie.
And resuscitated the disco scene.
Disco peaked at one point, I guess around 1974, and then it kind of died. I remember reading the script and seeing that this was a disco movie and saying, aren't we over this? The thing about Saturday Night Fever, it really revitalized the whole disco era.
And its fashions outfitted an entire culture.
That was the perfect fashion movie. You think of Saturday Night Fever and you think of John doing that pose in his white suit. And it was a good look for a guy.
It's clothing that was worn by the kids Saturday night after Saturday night after Saturday night.
I actually remember having like crazy tall shoes.
I love that whole ridiculous era with the bushy hair, you know, and the colorful shirts, and the ties that were this wide. It was very cool.
And there in the middle of the shopping center, there was a 30-foot high blow-up of Mr. Travolta in the white suit, and there were racks and racks and racks of them. And the kids who were going to the prom were all buying them as fast as they could. And I stopped my truck and I thought, what have I done?
But beneath its flashy surface was a raw, challenging film that was anything but light entertainment.
On the surface, Saturday Night Fever is all about the fashions of the 70s and the disco, and there's a lot of stuff where the film isn't afraid to deal with some of the darker aspects of these guys in their lives. There's date rape. There's suicide. There's racism.
So good. How could they be? They're spicks.
And there's homophobia.
You know why you don't kill fans?
It is a film that is about real people and real social issues.
You're dealing with stereotypes. You're dealing with misogyny, the way that we treated girls in that film. You know, you're dealing with a lot of really heavy subjects.
Just give me a blowjob, okay?
This movie today just would not happen. So many elements of how the story gets told would have been run through, the contemporary filter, and it would have been a much more vanilla kind of movie. And I think that's one of the reasons it still resonates, is that it's got, you know, a real edge to it.
Over 30 years later, the film's ingredients form a recipe that still delivers.
I've worked on a lot of big film, and this film, by all counts, is not a big film, but it has a soul to it.
Films like these, even though sometimes it's on the most trivial and lighthearted level, reach people because they speak to something universal.
At the center of the film is 19-year-old Tony Manero, paint store employee by day, but the king of the dance floor on Saturday night.
Here's this coarse, hopeless young guy who has a series of epiphanies, who grows as a human being.
I almost saw him very many times as a person submerged underwater, and every once in a while he'd see what it was all about.
I'm just not going back there, so.
He has so much energy, he has so much life, he is just really raw and naked in Saturday Night Fever.
Tony's crew, known in the film as The Faces, featured Double J, the hothead with a trigger finger temper.
I was probably the lieutenant of the gang, so to speak, the enforcer, but my big flaw was the fact that I had a temper.
Stop!
That always created a problem when it came down to it.
Joey, the freewheeling jokester.
My character was like keeping things going, doing a lot of speed. And humor and what's happening next.
Hey, so sure, it's the Barracuda.
Gus, a well-meaning screw-up.
I was so insecure about the role that I figured, okay, that's going to be the basis of Gus. The fact that he's so insecure, doesn't know what to do, doesn't know how to fit in.
Tony, I got to marry her. She won't get the abortion.
And the troubled hero-worshipping Bobby C.
Bobby C, there's a certain fragility right from the get-go. You realize this guy, it's not going to take much to push him over the edge.
Trying to be one of the gang is needy, smitten Annette.
I've been thinking, maybe I'll make it with you.
That's what you call thinking, huh? Jesus.
Who will do anything to win Tony's affections.
I thought, we all know this girl. Everyone went to school with this girl. That person that wants so desperately to fit in and be liked.
And into Tony's comfortable world steps Stephanie Mangano, a young woman from the neighborhood who desperately aspired to escape to the glittery promise of Manhattan.
Lauren's so pretty, man. He's the greatest actor in the whole world. He's the English actor, the one on television.
Oh, him. Oh, he's good.
Yeah.
She was fighting against trying to be cool and
create an act where she was sophisticated and she could survive and rise in the world. So she was sort of a symbol of what was really going on with women in 1977.
Saturday Night Fever not only tapped into the hopes and fears of the era, but like any good coming-of-age film, transcended those elements to become something more universal.
We weren't too far out of Vietnam. It was a very disaffected generation. Part of what the appeal of the movie is, in hindsight, is that it kind of capsulized that kind of disaffected youths.
They got it all locked up. Ain't nobody gonna give you a chance.
Nobody gives you nothing, Joe.
The genesis of Saturday Night Fever was in 1971, when John Travolta, just 17, auditioned for Robert Stigwood's production of Jesus Christ Superstar. Ted Neely would get the job, but Stigwood wrote himself a note about Travolta, saying this kid will be a very big star. 5 years later, Stigwood saw Travolta again, this time as Vinnie Barbarino on Welcome Back, Kotter. And on September 25th, 1976, he held a press conference at the Beverly Hills Hotel to announce the Robert Stigwood Organization had signed the 22-year-old sitcom actor to an eye-opening contract.
I thought he'd make a good movie star. So I gave him $1 million for three films. After that, I was looking for a first film to launch him. And I happened to read Nick Kern's Tribal Rights of a Saturday Night. It was the perfect film.
Tribal Rights of the New Saturday Night detailed a blue-collar neighborhood kid's bleak existence, which was brightened one night out of the week by a trip to the disco. Stigwood snatched up the rights, considering it the right vehicle to launch his new star.
We were really excited about the article, decided to buy it preemptively, gave it to John to read. John fell in love with it.
The film was scheduled to shoot in the months leading up to what Stigwood thought would be his real hit with Travolta. Grease. Saturday Night Fever was simply the starter picture of the deal.
Grease had the big budget. That was the guaranteed hit. That was the built-in success.
Grease was the movie that had a pedigree. It had been running on Broadway for 10 years previous to that. And it was also a studio movie. And, you know, we were this weird little independent movie.
I thought it was a small art film. I thought that was just a stepping stone.
Eventually, this stepping stone would turn John Travolta into a star, but with a profanity-laced script.
Yeah, we'll do it.
Mob threats.
And they basically threatened to shut us down, and they threw a firebomb at the nightclub.
And hysteria over star John Travolta.
These kids were out to get him.
Saturday Night Fever almost never made it to the silver screen. On June 7th, 1976, an article was published in New York Magazine called Tribal Rights of the New Saturday Night. Written by Nick Cohn, a British rock journalist considered a pioneer of rock criticism, the article was a vivid portrait of the world of working-class Brooklyn kids called the Faces, who inhabited and ruled the local discos.
Nick Cohn came into the club to speak to my dad, and he wanted to write an article about people, the young people in the boroughs, basically blue-collar, hard-working kids who work 9 to 5 Monday through Friday, and they basically lived for the weekend and prided themselves on getting a new suit or a new dress and going out dancing. It was a tremendous part of their lives.
Now, I had read Nick Cohn's article, The Tribal Rights of Saturday Night, before I even knew anything about this movie. I thought the article was incredible. It was actually frightening because it was like this whole group of young Italian kids in Brooklyn living out that fantasy.
The Italian guys in the clubs were definitely very cocky, very sure of themselves. This was the part of the city that they owned. Nick Cohn and I both gravitated to this one guy. I photographed him. He was with a friend. He just had that aura of being the leader of the pack, and it was one of the illustrations I did for the magazine.
That leader was named Vincent in the article. He was the best dancer in Bay Ridge, whose dream was to escape its dead-end streets. Producer Robert Stigwood, thinking it would be a great fit for his new contract player, snapped up the rights to the article. But the journey from the page to the screen would be a challenging trek through uncharted territory, especially for a very green 23-year-old executive producer.
I'd been Stigwood's executive assistant for a number of years, and I got this new job when he started a new company, executive in charge of film and television development and production. And I said to him, well, what does that mean? He said, you've got to go and get a director. And I went out to all of the agencies with my magazine article under my arm, and I went to see one particular agent, and the guy said, you know what, kid, my clients do movies, they don't do magazine articles. I didn't really know what I was doing.
McCormick, all set to head back to New York, then received a phone call from that same agent who repped a director named John Abelson.
He said, you know what, kid, you're in luck. That client you wanted to see read it and he has some interest, but you better see his new movie first.
His new movie was a small-budget film called Rocky. It would eventually go on to win 3 Academy Awards and make unknown Sylvester Stallone a superstar in the process. After screening the film, Stigwood and McCormick brought Abelson on board to helm Saturday Night Fever.
John was incredibly excited about what this could be. He met with John Travolta. That seemed to click. And he had a particular writer that he'd collaborated with before, who he thought was the perfect guy to write this, who was Norman Wexler.
Norman Wexler had written the gritty, critically acclaimed Serpico 3 years earlier. He also suffered from a bipolar disorder, which fed his reputation as being difficult to work with. He was, after all, a man once arrested for threatening to kill President Nixon.
And I decided I would go with him. He unnerved me a little on the first meeting because he had a bag on the floor. And when it was loosely open, I saw a gun in it.
Rounding out this ragtag creative team was pop group The Bee Gees.
One of the reasons why we used The Bee Gees is because Robert Stigwood managed them. He called me and he said, go downstairs and get this magazine. And there's an article in there called The Tribal Rights of Saturday Night. Stigwood called me back after I read the article and said, I'm gonna make a movie out of that and you're gonna have a big soundtrack. You know, just from the article.
It was a bit of hubris on the part of Stigwood as the Bee Gees were at a career low. Brothers Barry, Robin, and Morris Gibb had big hits in the 60s and early 70s, including To Love Somebody and How Can You Mend a Broken Heart? But by 1974, they had bottomed out.
They were dead. They were a wonderful part of the whole British invasion, and they scored, and then they vanished. I don't think anyone I knew had thought of the Bee Gees in years except as a kind of an oldies band.
They had had a big career early on, and then there was several years between hits for them.
Though the production was not exactly on steady ground, Stigwood's faith in the project never wavered, and he opted to put up his own money for the $3.5 million film before any other financing was in place. The talk in Hollywood was that Stigwood had lost his mind. But confidence was not a problem for the 42-year-old Stigwood. He had pioneered a new recording industry financial model, producing albums with his own money, and then getting record companies to handle distribution for a percentage of the profits. It had changed the face of the British recording industry and made him one of the most successful entertainment figures of the 60s and 70s. With a solid track record and no small amount of bravado, Stigwood followed his instincts.
Stigwood trusted himself, didn't need a consigliere. He trusted his finger on the pulse of the youth. And I think for him, it was every step of the way was a calculated risk.
As production geared up, Norman Wexler began the considerable task of fleshing out the article into a feature-length screenplay.
Norman would write all night, and then I would show up at his apartment in Chelsea, which consisted of a bed, a table, and two chairs. And he would be getting up, and he would have, you know, whatever work he'd done the night before for me to read. And when he finished, they turned in a screenplay that was really alive and very exciting. We were thrilled with it.
It was so true to life. I mean, you know, I grew up knowing some of these characters, the F word and all that stuff, that was used every day. I mean, it was just, it was a way of speaking.
Yeah, well, do it.
People think that we were, the four-letter words, the cursing was all just improvised. If I show you the script, every other line by every character is a curse word.
The script and the character are very authentic. And the language that's used in this movie is necessary to portray it properly. If you nixed it, it would be false.
Enthusiasm for Wexler's script was not unanimous, however. John Avildsen, fueled by the critical acclaim surrounding Rocky, began to pick apart the Fever script, eventually rethinking the whole tenor of the movie.
Rocky had become this absolute, you know, breakout hit, and Avildsen had a lot of other options and a lot of other ideas, and so he began to rethink a lot of things.
There was a disagreement on what the screenplay would be.
Should Tony be at a paint store? Should Tony dance? He replaced Norman. There was a revolving door of writers that came in and out. Things had changed so much by the time the last draft came around.
The director started telling me a new story. Lots of business that wasn't in the Wexler script. Nothing to do with it. It was bloody awful.
Avildsen had envisioned a tougher, more streetwise film, as evidenced by his casting of tough guy character actor Ray Sharkey.
Ray Sharkey was Double J. And that was, I think, indicative of the fact that they were making the movie more like Mean Streets. The movie was really going to be tough.
But casting was not the only thing Avildsen wanted to change about Saturday Night Fever, as Robert Stigwood would soon learn from his young executive producer.
And I said, you know, there's one other thing I should tell you is that I was talking to Avildsen yesterday, and he doesn't really want to use the Bee Gees music.
Stigwood really knew that he wanted to make a movie that featured the Bee Gees and John Travolta, and they had some different slant on it.
Stigwood, a smile came across his face, and he said, look, tell Avildsen I want to see him tomorrow morning at the apartment at 10, and you should be there as well.
Stigwood, determined to get his film under control and back on course, was about to deliver some of the best and worst news of Avildsen's career.
When we make him.
As February 1977 rolled around, entertainment impresario Robert Stigwood prepared to go into production on his personally financed disco movie, Saturday Night Fever. But he found himself forced to deal with the director going rogue. John Avildsen, fresh off the success of Rocky, had reworked the project until it was no longer recognizable. He ditched the script, questioned whether the film should even feature dancing, and tried to make drastic changes to the Bee Gees' music.
He had some form of slow motion montage, you know, boy-girl thing, and he wanted a slow part because, you know, the motion came down. So the guys wrote a bridge to Stayin' Alive, and it was in a different key. We had taken a hit record and ruined it because you couldn't take something this infectious and put something this ridiculous in the middle of it.
It was abundantly clear that Avildsen was looking to make a different film than the one Stigwood imagined. An exasperated Stigwood, realizing the film needed to start shooting in less than a month, decided it was time for a face-to-face meeting with their director.
I showed up at 10 in the morning with Mr. Avildsen, and we're waiting to go into a meeting with Stigwood. The phone rings. Stigwood leaves the room.
It was my office saying, we should tip you off. He's just been nominated for an Academy Award.
Stigwood comes back in and he says to John, there's good news and there's bad news. The good news is you've been nominated for an Academy Award. bad news is you're fired. That was the end of Mr. Avildsen's supervision of Saturday Night Fever. And I said to Stig, well, now what do we do?
With Avildsen relieved of his duties, the original script by Norman Wexler was reinstated, as was the original music of the Bee Gees. The film star John Travolta was eager to begin so he could move on to the real jewel in the three-picture deal, Grease. But first, the production needed to find a new director.
I got on the phone. I began to call agents, friends, people in L.A. I had met John Badham. He had been a really esteemed television director. But I couldn't find Badham. I called his then-agent, and he said, well, you know, he's off with his family on a skiing trip. You send me the script, and I'll get it to him. And so we had to wait.
Like the rest of the production, director John Badham had very little feature film experience. And his only previous directing credit, the Bingo Long, Traveling All-Stars, and Motor Kings, had its share of problems, including star Richard Pryor walking off the film when he and the young director butted heads. His follow-up gig was the Motown production of The Wiz.
I went to see The Wiz with my partner at the time, Rob Cohen, who was the head of the movie division at Motown. And we said, this would make a great movie. So we got Universal to buy it, and we were going to make it and do the adaptation ourselves.
Unfortunately for Badham, it too would be fraught with trouble.
Come to find out that Motown now thinks, well, we should get Diana Ross in this to be the lead. And I said, well, guys, did you see the movie with Judy Garland? She was 15 and she was too old for it then. So I had to conspire how to get Universal to fire me off the movie, because I, honest to God, had no idea how to direct the movie with an adult woman playing Dorothy. And I said, what if we do the whole movie from her point of view? You know, we can see her feet or maybe her hands, but, you know, we don't have to see her, and it'll be really exciting. So the next day, I was fired.
Badham came in, God bless him, and he just sort of, you know, jumped right into it. He said, look, you got to cut this script. It's, you know, 100, at that point, it was like 160 pages long. But he basically loved the first draft of the script of Saturday Night Fever, and he loved the Bee Gees music.
Badham learned rather quickly that this film would be a far cry from the lavish $24 million production he just left.
So I went to Kennedy Airport. I met John Badham, introduced myself as head of production for Robert Stigwood organization and welcome, and I was here to help him. When we went back to the car with his luggage, there were two cars there. There was the limo, someone's limo, and there was my Datsun pickup truck. And Mr. Badham started to head for the limo. And I said, oh no. I said, let me have your luggage. We're gonna put it in the back in this garbage bag, and you're gonna sit next to me in the front.
With just 3 weeks before shooting was to begin, the production faced monstrous tasks. The script needed to be cut to manageable size. Locations, including the disco that would be the center of the film, needed to be secured. And most importantly, the cast to complement star John Travolta needed to be hired. Badham scrambled and wiped the casting slate clean.
Every young actor in New York wanted to be a part of this movie. There were 200 people up for four roles.
Are you done, Muff?
Hey, don't you never chew, Tony. Don't you never chew.
John Travolta, myself, Ray Liotta, David Caruso were doing about a 40-minute improv. And I actually got cast out of that. And Ray and David, who, you know, were all coming up at the time, struggling in New York, didn't get the part, and they were all pissed off at me. I was so thrilled.
Been it. Cigarette.
I had nothing to lose. It's the first film I'd ever auditioned for. And I had a lot of fool's courage in those days, so I just went for it. And a couple of days later, I called my agent, and he goes, well, your first film, and you've got 15 weeks of work. And I went, really? Really?
Ain't you gonna ask me to sit down?
No, you do it.
I had auditioned for it a couple of times when John Avildsen was set to direct, and then it went away for a month or two. But when I went in again with John Badham, I had auditioned, I guess, two or three times, and found out on a Friday that I was starting work on a Monday. So, and then read the script over the weekend.
Nobody has any idea how much I'm growing.
Once you go on a diet.
Some guy that I hustled into sharing the taxi with me mentioned, oh, I'm making a movie, and my little antenna went up.
Stephanie, I think, shared a taxi with my nephew or something once and found out about the auditions.
I think she was actually written as a 17 or 18-year-old to begin with, and then once they got interested in using me, they added some age to her so that she would be older, which of course I was, than Travolta.
With the cast in place, Robert Stigwood continued to try and find a studio to distribute Fever. No small task, as a cast of unknowns and a novice production staff was a risky proposition for any studio.
I was, you know, with very little experience, this guy that was supervising a movie that had been financed completely by Stigwood. We had no distributor. There was no studio.
Even John Travolta, an ensemble player on the sitcom Welcome Back, Kotter, was a totally unproven commodity on the big screen.
Yes, it was a risk. I mean, no one knew that this guy on film would be a supernova.
With 6 months of intensive dance lessons, Travolta prepared for the role with dance coach Danny Terrio.
My role really was taking John and turning him into a dance sex symbol. John didn't say a lot. He watched, and he was a little insecure. And I remember John going, I can't do this, Danny.
Travolta also went through rigorous strength training with Jimmy Gambina, a holdover from Avildsen's time on the film. Gambina, who whipped Sylvester Stallone into shape for Rocky, was tasked with perfecting Travolta's physique for the role.
I had a gym above stage 5 at MGM for Raging Bull. And John would show up early after I'd finished working De Niro out. And De Niro used to get a little aggravated that the kid would show up because he knew he was a TV actor, and Stallone knew I was working with him. He's saying, why are you working with, you know, a TV actor when you have Robert De Niro?
But Gambina, just as he had with the unknown Stallone a year earlier, believed in Travolta and helped him shave 30 pounds off his frame, having him run up to 35 miles a week for 5 months, in addition to stretching, boxing, and cardio workouts.
He was pretty heavy on from the waist down, and he was very diligent about wanting to get in good shape. We've trained for months, and I got this kid in great shape. He could go for the next 3 weeks dancing the way he's dancing and not run out of gas, because that's the kind of shape I have.
With the pieces falling into place, the production now faced the Herculean task of getting the movie in the can in just 38 days. But when Hollywood rolled into Bay Ridge, things would turn ugly, as the locals and the mafia were about to put star John Travolta and the production of Saturday Night Fever in imminent danger. By the spring of 1977, Saturday Night Fever had overcome more than its share of obstacles. But the low-budget indie still had its problems. There was no studio in place to distribute the film. They were weeks behind schedule due to casting and directorial changes. And with less than 2 weeks before the cameras were set to roll, they were in need of over 60 locations. Most importantly, the disco that would be the heart of the movie.
The original discotheque mentioned in the New York Magazine article was basically like an airplane hangar. It was very uninteresting. And so each night around 1 o'clock in the morning, Travolta, Avildsen, and my wife would go, and I would go to all these discotheques, checking them out.
I flew back in for a location scout in New York, and we go into a building and people start walking up the stairs. I said, I'll take the elevator. I want to see how big it is. How do we get the equipment? And they said, oh, well, there's no elevator. We're going to hoist everything up on cables and pulleys. I said, forget about it. I said, get back in the van. We're going to find another spot.
The search continued, but the right location eluded the crew.
I looked at a lot of discos in the week and a half that I had to prepare this movie. And I kept going back to the one that we used, which was the one that the magazine article had been written about, and it made the most sense. The trouble was that the place looked kind of dreary inside. The floor was just sort of this brown old hardwood floor, and the walls were really plain.
It was so disappointing because it was so shabby. The pretension to be like a hip club was so pathetic because it was dark and heavy, dinky little lights.
Short on money and time, the crew scrambled to bring the disco to life on film.
I remember it being complicated and always having to work on small budget. But Ralph Boda had the idea of crinkling up tinfoil and putting it all over the walls. And I mean, Ralph Boda, I think, really made that place come to, look special.
The crew offset this inexpensive bit of set dressing with the most expensive prop in the film, one that would become nearly as iconic as Travolta's white suit.
Where I was growing up in Alabama, there was a club there that had a dance floor that was lit from underneath. There's a company in New York that actually makes these things. That was our $15,000, and with the remainder of his budget, he bought Christmas lights, so it gave it more depth.
The difference between the club that we had seen and the club in the movie was quite shocking. It went from shabby to miraculously glamorous. There was an incredible transformation.
And we took the owner of the disco to Daly's one day and, you boys make my place look great.
With the disco location set, the crew scoured Bay Ridge to find the rest of the locations called for in the film's script. With the first day of shooting less than a week away, time was short, and securing dozens of locations with no budget presented its own challenges.
I was given practically no money. I was told to get most of them for free, or $50, $100. And the key to unlocking the locations was the magical mystery words, John Travolta, because everybody's girlfriend or daughter or whatever was in love with John and the sweat hogs. This auto dealership used to be the coffee shop. That was where Tony Manero and Stephanie had their so-called sophisticated conversation.
The Romeo and Juliet, I never understood why Romeo, he took the poison so quick, you know? I feel like he could have waited or something.
Well, that's the way they took the poison in those days.
And here's Phillips Dance Studio, the place where Tony Manero gave the heave-ho to Annette.
I changed my mind about us dancing together. I got another partner.
Why do you hate me so much?
This is the Tony Manero household. As you can see, it's very opulent. We had to uglify it in order to make the place look more Brooklyn.
We just washed the hair.
Yeah, and here is the famous bench where Stephanie and Tony Manero sat and looked at the bridge.
I know everything about the bridge.
The thing that made that film so special was that it was all in the streets. It was all in the locations. Mesmerized audiences. They wanted more of it. They wanted to see New York.
As locations were slowly but surely lined up, filming began on March 14, 1977. And from day one, it was quite clear that John Travolta had arrived.
People kept saying to me that John Travolta on the set would be a security risk. And I said, why? And they said, oh, he's very popular. Have you ever seen Welcome Back, Carter? And I said, you must be joking. Who's going to pay any attention to John Travolta, you know? Well, I learned my lesson the first day of shooting.
It just started with three or four young girls just waving at him and going, "Hey, Barbarino." And a couple of minutes later, that number had doubled and then doubled and doubled again. And suddenly, all of Brooklyn, it seemed, had come out to see him. And we literally couldn't turn the camera in any direction without seeing people.
We had three or four cops, and there were, it ended up being 10,000 girls on the street, so we basically had to shut down.
Even if I pointed straight up, there were kids hanging over the building up above. We had to go home by noon the first day because we had nothing we could shoot.
While the fanaticism for Travolta was just a nuisance at first, it would quickly turn into a more threatening situation.
I had never witnessed anything remotely like that. One evening, we were shooting and we were sitting in a trailer.
And all of a sudden, the trailer is like shaking and shaking. And apparently, John Travolta's groupies had, they thought that John was in there.
John's fans were literally shaking this trailer so he would come out. And it was scary.
The guys hate him right off the bat because the girls love him. So there was war going on over there.
I had to run security for him as well because these kids were out to get him.
We threw John into a limousine, and I remember being on the back tail of the car like a Secret Service agent of Kennedy, throwing teenagers off the car to get him out. So after that, we would have decoys. We'd put people up in raincoats and say, there he goes, and then we'd sneak him out the back.
When you have 10,000 to 20,000 kids, you cannot stop them. There was no way that we were going to get out of there unless we played it the way we played it.
We just had to stay inside as much as possible. And if we had a scene on the street, we did fake call sheets. We'd open up at like 6 in the morning and try to get out of there by 8:30 so people wouldn't discover us.
But Travolta's fans were not the only ones to put the production in danger, as the cast and crew would soon find out.
These kids in the neighborhood were there all the time, and they were very concerned about keeping you real, keeping you on the beam.
I remember going up to one of these guys saying, "Hey, we're in this movie. We're like, you know, we're portraying you guys. Hey, f*** you, who cares?" They had a real attitude about who they were, and there was a certain amount of danger.
I remember a lot of people that would watch with, you know, a little bit of anger, saying, you know, do this right or we're not going to be happy. You know, this is our neighborhood, this is our area, and basically do it right or you're not going to do it.
No matter where I was making sure that the neighborhood knew and accepted and bought into to the production, because you know, the local people can cause you tremendous problems.
We were being attacked by the Hasidic Jews because we were shooting in their neighborhood, and we're in the car getting ready to go, and all of these Hasidic people came out and started rocking the car. We were being attacked by the mafia.
The local mafia guy who was trying to shake us down and hire local people for security, and they basically threatened to shut us down, and they threw a sort of lame firebomb at the nightclub one night after we wrapped.
And a guy got out, he had to have weighed 350 pounds, and he just kind of comes waddling up to the production manager and says, "Here, you boys had a little barbecue here last night." And I kind of go up afterwards and say, what did he want? He said, "Well, he wanted money."
We ended up paying some people off a chunk of cash, and it was an education.
With protection money paid and Travolta's security issue worked out, filming would continue. But the production was about to be upended again. This time, there would be temper tantrums and creative clashes, but also a deeply affecting personal tragedy.
Well,
after a rocky gestation period, Saturday Night Fever began filming in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn on March 14, 1977. With local mafia pressure averted and teeming fanaticism for John Travolta now under control, Fever seemed to finally be on the right path. These production issues must have been little more than background noise to Travolta, who at age 23 was facing one of the hardest personal challenges of his life. Travolta's girlfriend, actress Diana Hyland, had been diagnosed with breast cancer. Travolta was aware of her illness throughout pre-production, but the actress, believing the film would make Travolta a star, insisted he forge ahead. 2 weeks into shooting, John flew to California to be with Diana one last time. She died in his arms on March 27th. Back in New York, the news of Hyland's death cast an air of uncertainty over the film's production.
There was a question about, well, when is he coming back? And how quickly is he going to want to start working again? And you know what? He jumped right back into it.
In between takes, he would go over and sit in the corner, sit on the floor, and just be all kind of hunched up. And you knew that it had affected him tremendously. And yet, when it was time to shoot, he'd get and just kind of force himself into whatever he was supposed to be doing.
We were sitting on a park bench looking at the bridge. He was fighting hard to keep it together to finish the film. And at that, there was a point where I leaned over and kissed him on the cheek.
All of a sudden, all these tears well up in his eyes. And she just holds his hand. And it just, that touched me the most. It just was brilliant because you had no idea what he was feeling. He just lost someone he was very close to and very much in love with.
As Travolta and the production forged ahead, they began to feel pressure from Paramount to wrap. The studio had decided 2 weeks into shooting that they would pick up and distribute what they termed that little disco movie. It was now April of 1977. And with Grease set to start filming in June, there was precious little time to get Fever in the can.
We absolutely had to finish because John was due at rehearsals for Grease, which was a big deal over on the Paramount lot. It's much bigger than anything we had. So I was under the gun to get it done.
The increasing pressure complicated by the emotional turmoil of recent events brought the stress of the production to a head on the Verrazano Narrows Bridge.
When you're on that bridge, it's like no other place you've ever been in your life. I mean, there are sounds, the wind. There's a kind of a sway to the bridge. There's danger everywhere. You know, wherever you step, there's a chance you may go over.
Bobby! Hey, you punk! Turn it!
Get down! It's too dangerous!
The scene on the Verrazano Bridge was particularly challenging.
We were on steel beams that got icy as it got cold.
It was shot at night. We had to light it. We had to make sure no one fell off.
We're out of our minds. I swear to God, that whole thing, we were 2 feet from actually getting to the actual edge, and it was windier than hell up there.
I'm about 300 feet above the water and blowing wind. I just said, let's go for it.
And then, stupid me, I went out on the beam as well with the handheld camera and tried to show, like, John's feet slipping.
While the production got through the evening physically unscathed, the scene was not without conflict. Creative differences between Travolta and Badham came to a head when Badham shot the stunt portion of the final bridge scene without consulting Travolta.
I show them what the stunt people did, and John said, well, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be kneeling down at this position trying to save Barry Miller. I want to be standing up. And I said, well, I thought that kneeling down, trying to crawl out, is you're trying to stay safe. He said, no, I want to show him how confident I am. And I went, well, we've already shot it that way with the stuntmen. He said, well, that's not my problem. you can shoot it again. I said, well, the stuntmen have gone home, and in fact, this is the only night we're here. He just turned around and said, I'll be in my trailer. I realized I was stuck. I mean, we had to do it his way or no way at all.
The incident was minor compared to the creative battle over the film's central dance solo.
Because I worked on it for 9 months and perfected it, and then I can even remember that it was being cut in the final version in a close-up, and I had a fit. And I even cried at the first showing.
Horrified at Badham's handling of the sequence, and feeling that the work he put into the scene was compromised, Travolta informed producer Robert Stigwood that he was walking off the film.
It was the set piece, it was the heartthrob of that movie. And with it being edited in close-up, it didn't work.
Now he's worked for 5 months. And then he has a director coming in saying, you know, we really don't. We're just gonna shoot you. We just want you to do this, and we want to see your face. And John was, he was pissed.
John Badham just had a different notion of how he was gonna shoot the movie, and it really became, in this moment, it just a mano a mano between these two guys about how it was gonna evolve. It finally had to be brokered that Badham had to give in.
So I went back to the studio at Paramount, and I re-edited it where you could see the whole body dance, because I couldn't believe that they had cut it in close-up.
John Badham did not understand the importance of the dance. But when you walked out of that movie, you walked out of that movie going, man, I can't wait to get into those clubs, you know what I mean? Where's the white suit?
When you think about the stones that it took, you know, for a guy, and the commitment and the passion that it took for a kid who's 23 years old to talk to any director like that, and to go to Stigwood and go, I'm gonna quit this movie? And to have Stigwood have the sense to go, you know what, he's right. That's one of those great happy accidents of American culture.
Just give me a blowjob, right?
As footage made its way to the Paramount executives, studio heads began to chafe over the tone of the film.
When Paramount saw the director's cut of the movie, they were just horrified, all this language. Nobody really had ever done a film that had that much bad language in it.
What is it, man? What the is it?
They were begging me to go in and clean out the language. And the thing that saved me and saved the film was that the producer, Robert Stigwood, had final cut. And he had insisted on financing it with his own money. And only once that he was satisfied that the cut was okay the way he wanted would he accept money from Paramount.
I had lunch with Barry Diller. So he said, will you consider changing the language for an extra 5% of the gross? I said, you can take the word f*** out 5 times.
Stigwood's new agreement with Paramount would still give him final cut on the film, as well as 45% of the gross, a back-end deal unheard of in the film industry. But it was not without risk. When the film went $1 million over budget, the additional funds came out of Stigwood's pocket. Robert Stigwood's faith would eventually earn him over $100 million, more than 20 times his initial investment. This astonishing figure would be overshadowed, however, by a soundtrack that would become the biggest selling album in history. By the summer of 1977, Saturday Night Fever, the small independent film helmed by an inexperienced director with a TV actor as the lead and a cast of unknowns, had finally completed shooting. Post-production brought a new set of challenges, not the least of which was a faltering pop band, the Bee Gees, tasked with creating the film's disco soundtrack. Insiders were skeptical, but once again, producer Robert Stigwood had faith and a plan.
I thought the Bee Gees would be very good to write the disco music and other ballads.
It was perhaps easy for Stigwood to be enthusiastic about the band. They were, after all, already under contract to him. And with his stake in the band, using their music meant more money in his pocket. In 1967, Beatles manager Brian Epstein, a friend and colleague of Robert Stigwood, gave him demo tapes of the Brothers Gibb. After auditioning the band, Stigwood immediately signed them.
Stigwood was a visionary. This is a guy who saw things, who heard things that other people couldn't see or hear. He was brilliant.
Comparisons between the fledgling group and the Beatles began when their second British single, New York Mining Disaster 1941, was issued to radio stations with a blank white label showing only the song title. Assuming it was a new Beatles single, DJs started playing the song in heavy rotation. But while the Bee Gees were once a promising young band, by the early 70s, it seemed they were finished.
And up to that point, I think in 1973 or 74, we were pretty much done for.
The brothers had broken up at one point and were troubled by drug, alcohol, and legal problems, and their records were not selling. But Stigwood, undaunted, saw the potential.
I knew the music was absolutely right for the times. I had to tell them a story, and then they would write to order, which the Bee Gees are brilliant at.
We were looking to revitalize ourselves or to do something with great energy. It was during that time that Robert called up and told us all about this article by Nick Conn, or Tribal Rights of a New Saturday Night. He said, can you give me some ideas for songs for it? And a few ideas which had been rolling around at that point were Night Fever and Staying Alive. And that's how it started.
But Stigwood faced an uphill battle against Paramount executives. Besides employing a band whose better days were behind them, Saturday Night Fever was also considered a little disco movie in a world where disco had already died. But buoyed by Stigwood's faith, the Brothers Gibb would record an album that would be the turning point of their career and the entire 70s music scene.
Staying Alive was the first song that I heard. I was out in the studio and I said, well, what are we going to record? And Barry says, well, have I got a song for you? You know, and he showed me the rhythm. I said, don't forget that rhythm. He said, I never will.
When I showed up on my first day, Robert handed me a cassette and said, here's three number one hits. And I thought, that's really arrogant. How do you know something's going to be a number one hit?
As soon as, you know, the first few bars went down, you always knew, boy, there's something right there. You just had to move when you heard this rhythm.
The more I heard it, the more I loved it. I mean, it was not something you thought, oh God, here's that music again. It was just, wow, here's this music again.
I'm not even sure whether I was even familiar with the Bee Gees before then. But hearing that music, we were just absolutely blown away.
John Travolta played for us the Bee Gees songs, broken down, just piano and vocals, or guitar and vocals, and it was like weird. I was floored.
The reason I knew something special was happening with Fever was the music.
We hadn't heard the soundtracks until the third week of the production. And the day we heard the soundtrack, everyone went, this is a winner. I mean, this is incredible.
Now we have Stephanie Mangano and Tony Manero.
As one of the top names in the British pop industry, Robert Stigwood had a keen insight into the music business, enabling him to devise a plan that would floor both movie and music execs. He realized that the film and the soundtrack could promote one another, boosting the sales of both.
I said, what's ideal for you? When do you want this first song to be number one? He said, a week before the film opens. I said, when's your film opening? And he told me. I went back 8 weeks before that and put the record out, and my timing was near perfect.
The first single, How Deep Is Your Love, entered the charts at number 74 on September 24th, 1977. It would rocket its way to number 2 by December 10th, the week Saturday Night Fever opened. It hit number 1 a week later, followed by 2 more number 1s, Stayin' Alive and Night Fever, just as Stigwood had predicted.
And we have suddenly reached another level, you know, a level we never dreamed we could reach. So from being pretty much dead in the water in 1973 and 74, we were certainly back again.
The soundtrack to Saturday Night Fever would go on to sell 40 million copies, making it the best-selling album in history, until Michael Jackson's Thriller was released 6 years later. But while Stigwood's genius made the musical component of Fever a smash, as the premiere of the film drew closer, it would be dogged by discouraging previews and withering criticism. In the fall of 1977, Saturday Night Fever was set to hit theaters. While the cast and crew had high hopes, early word was discouraging. Previews in Cincinnati and Columbus, Ohio, reported walkouts as the film's harsh language and sexual content bruised local sensibilities.
Because you won't get the abortion.
Reviews weren't much better. While a few singled out the performance of John Travolta, critics were appalled by the profanity, racism, and homophobia that permeated the film's dialogue.
You know why you don't kill fat guys?
How could they be this spics?
The movie was greeted with, you know, derision, with contempt. The movie was panned as kind of a piece of trash, very coarse, very vulgar.
The real shock was when somebody handed me the Daily Variety review, which said, well, this piece of junk is not even going to last through the weekend.
The sexuality on display also caused a stir.
There were some complaints in the reviews about how we were lovingly passing the camera over his body as he's in his underwear. We're really trying to get inside of this character's head and see, you know, how does he see things? How does he imagine things? So the whole style of shooting there was very extreme.
Saturday Night Fever opened on Friday, December 16th, 1977. And while few had any hopes for its success, besides Robert Stigwood, the cast, and crew, what happened over the opening weekend was amazing even to them.
When we actually saw people going around the block, like here at the Chinese Theater, we were going, whoa, this is great. And the Paramount executives just couldn't believe their eyes. They thought people had showed up by mistake to the wrong theater.
When I saw the movie and we began to screen it, it began to have an incredible reaction among people. So I think our confidence grew.
The reaction of the people afterwards, it wasn't just great, it was like, holy smokes. And then it started, it became a real wave.
On Sunday mornings in those days, you had to call up a phone number to find out how the movie did over the weekend financially. The head of Paramount at that time was Barry Diller. He's at a friend of mine's house. He calls up to get the number, and my friend hears him yelling at the person on the other end of the line saying, you're wrong. There's too many zeros here. That's not right. And that shows you how much faith that he had in the movie.
Saturday Night Fever exploded at the box office, grossing more than $11 million in its first 11 days.
By the time Christmas was over that year, we were everywhere. And it was, you know, one of the top grossing pictures of the year. And John ended up getting nominated for an Academy Award.
Well, how are you taking all of this sudden celebrity? I mean, this superstardom that's coming your way as a result of this movie.
It makes me very happy. Mm-hmm.
What if you would win an Oscar now?
The excitement would be for days, okay?
At least.
At least.
If not years.
I mean that kind of before I settled down, that type of thing. The validation would last forever.
Travolta didn't win the Oscar that year. Instead, it went to Richard Dreyfuss for The Goodbye Girl. But Saturday Night Fever would go on to gross over $300 million worldwide, fueled by a soundtrack that has sold more than 40 million copies. With the film's success, Paramount executives hit upon the idea that a PG cut of the film would allow the many youngsters who'd bought the album a chance to spend a few more dollars on the movie. But the cast was reticent to go along with the studio's plan.
So I called all the actors over and I said, guys, you're all new to the Screen Actors Guild, right? I said, yeah. Do you know what residuals are?
No, what's that?
I said, every time it gets played on television, you get a check. And if we can't play this on television, then there's no way you're gonna see any residuals.
Okay, let's do that TV version, guys.
The PG version of the film did indeed increase the film's box office, but also compromised its impact.
And it ruined the film. It doesn't have the power of the original cutting.
You know how many times somebody told me I was good in my life? Two times. I mean, how many times in my life somebody told me I was good? Two times. You sure as never did. You sure as hell never did.
Paramount continued to cash in on the film years later, in 1983's Stayin' Alive. Travolta reprised his role in a story that followed Tony Manero as he tries to make it as a dancer on Broadway. At first, the script was tied more directly to the original film, with several characters returning. But the film's director, Sylvester Stallone, changed gears and focused solely on the character of Tony.
It talked about, you know, bringing us in to do those scenes, which I had read. I saw the script. And then he decided to completely drop that portion of the story and just focus on the New York dance and, you know, Tony's life now, and not go back and revisit anything else. So I was disappointed, not because of not working. I was disappointed about the continuation of seeing what happens to those guys as they get older and they're stuck in that dead-end, you know, environment.
While the sequel was a financial hit, it was critically skewered, described as a dancing Rocky. Ironically, the kind of film Stigwood feared Avildsen would create in 1977. And while Stayin' Alive was quickly forgotten, Saturday Night Fever seemed to grow in the memories of moviegoers, thanks in no small part to key moments.
We just washed the hair.
And key scenes.
Tony!
That would make Saturday Night Fever a modern masterpiece.
John, I'm sorry. It's over.
Just dig it.
I knew that you could.
Fans of Saturday Night Fever know the film to be a treasure trove of memorable lines.
I've been thinking. Maybe I'll make it with you.
That's what you call thinking, huh?
Iconic performances and indelible scenes.
Tony! Bobby, get down! It's too dangerous!
The cast and crew of the film have their own favorites.
He hit my hair.
He hits my hair.
And it all starts with the unforgettable title sequence. But typical of the low-budget film with no prospects and no expectations, even this seemingly simple scene had its share of problems.
The close shots of the feet are actually John's double, because John could not be there for several days. His very, very close girlfriend, Diana Hyland, had died of a cancer. When John came back, I said, okay, here's what we had to do while you were gone. And he said, well, I don't walk like that. And I go, well, you weren't here. So we had to do it however. Well, that's not my problem.
Badham finally came to a compromise with his young star and reshot some of the scene. The final film version is a mix of both Travolta and his stand-in. The scene also presented a challenge for the crew, who, like their director, were forced to think on their feet.
It was just one of those things you do when you're working New York. It's kind of like being street smart, you know, you adapt to what you have. Ralph and myself came up with the idea of putting me on the Western Dolly, which is basically a square platform with balloon tires. They made a cross for me, actually. They made a cross that was hinged on the dolly. I laid on it, and at a certain point, two grips lifted me up his body and went up to his face.
Improvising was encouraged across the board by director John Badham, much to the delight of the fledgling cast.
In any good film, that's what happens, is some kind of something new that you hadn't thought of when the camera's rolling. That was total improv. That we'd never done that before. Everything was very realistic.
Out of nowhere, it jumped up on the table and started barking like a dog. Something came over me, and so I remember that scene just for the sheer energy of it and the fun of it.
Whatever was written was not what we ultimately ended up saying.
So when's Connie gonna get her answer, huh?
One of the things that I did was say, you know, when's Connie gonna get her answer? Because I wanted to establish myself as having a name, so I wouldn't just be credited as, you know, girl in bar. He let me do that. And, you know, he certainly didn't stop me from touching Travolta's butt as we walked onto the dance floor. That was my idea.
John Travolta also had ideas, and thanks to his intuitive feel for the role of Tony Manero, he provided some of the most memorable improvisational moments in the film.
He understood the character so well and has such a good sense of humor that he'd come up with stuff that was better than what was on the page.
So did you make that up?
Yeah. No, I saw it on TV first, and then I made it up.
It doesn't make any sense at all. That's what I love about it. It's just completely nonsensical. It's wonderful.
We just washed the hair. Yeah. You know, I work on my hair a long time, and you hit it. He hits my hair.
I let him go and say whatever he wanted to say. And, you know, we kept all of that stuff because it was so wonderful.
While improv carried a large part of the film, Norman Wexler's script also fueled some of Fever's more affecting scenes.
I love to watch you dance, Tony.
I felt there was a sweetness about her and a sadness. And I felt I could identify in some ways about how you feel like you never fit in.
She says, Tony, I love to watch you dance. And every time I see the movie, it just makes me smile because she does it with such complete adoration for him.
Tony, can I wipe off your forehead? I love to watch her dance, Tony.
I think everybody sort of felt like we love to watch Tony Manero dance.
Now we have Stephanie Mangano and Tony Manero!
One of the most powerful scenes in the movie occurs at the dance contest. It's a moment that inspires Tony's epiphany about the limits of his dead-end world.
A guy who is kind of masterful on the dance floor and a man of such honor that he's willing to give up first prize to the Puerto Rican couple because he understands innately.
So good.
That they're the deserving winners.
Congratulations. Yeah, I'd like to give you this, and I'd like to give you that, because I think you deserve it, all right?
A young man's growth to manhood. He needs to find something that he feels a passionate link to, and somehow uses that to vault himself into a better way of life.
Another of Saturday Night Fever's most powerful scenes is the gang rape of Annette. The shocking subject matter and brutal realism disturbed not only audiences, but the actors as well.
That scene obviously is one of the more memorable from the film because it is a very honest and raw and scary look at how far things go without necessarily meaning to go there.
With me, she's gonna cry?
When you're basically going to violate someone who is also your friend, there is a line there that you have to cross as an actor, but as a friend, you're concerned about going there. And there was a lot of discussion about that because in order to make it really real, we had to really disrespect her.
Donna and I talked about it. We just said, look, we're actors, we're gonna do this. And it, of course, it was really uncomfortable. But I think we just got past that. And I think it really enhanced the film, that kind of reality.
Saturday Night Fever's uncompromising mix of brutal realism, honest emotion, and down-to-earth comedy would burn a lasting image in the minds of viewers. But it was John Travolta's star-making turn as king of the dance floor, Tony Manero, that made the film a modern classic. By 1978, Saturday Night Fever had taken on a life of its own, selling out theaters month after month and changing the life of its young star.
It's an amazingly fluid and passionate performance, I guess fueled in part by the fact that he was literally in mourning for his girlfriend who had died. And everything is on, he left nothing in the locker room. Everything is on the screen. Every emotion seems genuine. Every movement seems to be organic.
I knew that we had a major undiscovered star. From the first day that I worked with him, you could see the charisma and the power that he had over other people.
The day he showed up, I just remember thinking, oh my gosh, he's here, I can't believe it. You know, I was 10, I was a gushing schoolgirl, you know, with a crush.
Hey, Tony!
Hey, hot stuff, give him a kiss.
At one point I had something in my eye, and he said, well, you know, let me see if I can get that out for you. So I'm sitting on a chair, and I'm looking up at him, and I'm thinking, he's beautiful, why am I 10?
John often would rehearse some of his dancing while we were on a break, and he would ask me to dance with him. And I've never, ever to this day danced with such a great leader on a dance floor. I mean, he is just it.
I mean, this guy can dance. Just the shape that he was in and the ability to do that was amazing. And I saw it when we first went into the rehearsal halls. I thought I could dance. Not even close. Really, not even close.
Gene Kelly's brother taught me in Oradell, New Jersey, my first tap lessons. My first tap lessons were at 7. And then I took jazz with Luigi in New York. He was a famous choreographer and teacher. So my natural abilities mixed with some training sent me off into to the theater.
Well, when we were doing the main dance scene, John had a number of moves that he would do out on the dance floor. We knew the A steps on John was the knee drops. I mean, nobody had ever seen those before. The clock splits when he went down and he went over and did that split. That was 6-3, 12-9. That was called a clock split. The steps that their women really loved was the arm movement and when he was doing those hips and when he pointed that finger out. This goes over the top. These are moves that showing I'm confident, I'm the man.
I can't imagine anyone in this movie. But Travolta, this, I mean, who else could have danced like that? Just a tremendous performance. I find almost unmatched in American film in my memory.
Travolta's looks, personality, and dance moves made him as big a hit with his co-stars as it did with audiences. But it was the 23-year-old's commitment to quality that won him the respect of the film's crew.
What he had was a sense of dedication, and his work ethic was so strong that it spilled out onto the entire crew.
And he had such enormous passion for dancing and for acting.
And they would rehearse 3 and 4 hours after shooting, so he would know the dance routines.
He was such a generous actor and person. He would say, do you feel good about that? Do you want another take? And at first I thought, wow, I didn't even know I was allowed to have another take. I had just found out what a take meant, you know, so I was, but he was always incredibly generous.
Kindest, gentlest, authentic. He just was kind. He made you better.
We had like some production conflicts. He really went to bat with the producers and the director for the sake of the film and for the good of the film. And And that integrity has always impressed me.
It was refreshing to see such a young man have so much dedication to his craft.
Travolta's performance clicked with an entire generation who identified with Tony Manero's coming-of-age journey.
We follow this character who has to struggle to move from, you know, Brooklyn to Manhattan, where the world is free and open, and where he can go on and have a breakthrough life. It takes a train to free himself. And at the end of the movie, you see John taking the train away from his past and out to his future, which is remarkable.
Like the character of Tony Manero, John Travolta's real-life journey through Saturday Night Fever would change his life, earning him an Academy Award nomination for Best Actor in the process. And though he didn't win, the movie instantly took him from a supporting actor to a motion picture superstar. He would go on to star in such hits as Grease, Urban Cowboy, and his 1994 comeback vehicle, Pulp Fiction.
I'm asked often, does it upset you that often you're remembered for Saturday Night Fever? My immediate thought is, well, would it have upset Jimmy Stewart for being remembered for It's a Wonderful Life, or Jimmy Cagney for Yankee Doodle Dandy? I mean, they are as closely identified with those roles as I am with Saturday Night Fever, and one wouldn't want to not be.
Today, Travolta's performance is credited with bringing to life the film's sometimes shockingly authentic tone. But this gritty story, heralded for its uncompromising realism, would eventually turn out to be pulled practically out of thin air.
As it turns out, people do make things up.
In 1977, Saturday Night Fever, a mix of flashy disco dance sequences and dark undertones, struck a chord with audiences everywhere. Over 30 years later, Fever's music and message continue to captivate new generations.
Staying alive is not about dancing. Staying alive is not about nightclubs. Staying alive is about surviving in the city, in New York City or any big city. Nothing to do with dancing.
You know how many times somebody told me I was good in my life? Two times.
There's a lot going on in Saturday Night Fever. It isn't just a bunch of silly dance scenes, and it isn't just a bunch of guys with big polyester collars.
Why do you hate me so much? All I ever did to you is like you.
The film isn't afraid to deal with some of the darker aspects of these guys in their lives.
You're a cliche. You're nowhere on your way to no place.
It's a movie about the imprisonment of family, the imprisonment of friends, the idea that you're born into a class, and even in America, trying to escape the class destiny that you were born into is fraught with all kinds of tension.
And what is with you?
There are things like a piece of music that you remember that really move you and take you back to a particular time, or a book. Or a day that you might experience. And I think people experience Saturday Night Fever like that. It takes them back now to a time where they once were that meant something to them. And I think the film resonates in people because of that.
Over the years, Fever has become so iconic, it's been spoofed on TV, in movies, and in print. It even spawned a TV series and a Broadway musical. Producer and financier Robert Stigwood's faith in the movie, the music, and John Travolta would help him turn his initial investment of $4.5 million into a multi-million dollar empire. Fever rocketed John Travolta from TV actor to cinema superstar, and the Bee Gees went on to become one of the best-selling recording groups of all time. And for some of the film's young cast and crew, success meant opportunity.
Well, it allowed me to do a lot of pictures that I probably wouldn't have been able to do otherwise. And I suddenly had, you know, a big choice of movies. So it was great, great good fortune for me that happened. And a lot of, you know, wonderful opportunities came along.
Saturday Night Fever for me really made me know that anything's possible. I've worked on a lot of movies since then, you know, I'm so grateful that I had the opportunity with it.
I've been very, very fortunate and still continue to work. And I think no matter what I do, to be a part of this iconic film and to do that kind of work so early on and to be well-received and well-respected is an unbelievable gift.
I was like a kid when I did that movie. So to be associated with a movie that is such a big box office success, it was a terrific building block. And as the years went on and the movie became more and more iconic and I became more and more successful, I feel really proud of that because it's such a superb movie.
But for many, Saturday Night Fever turned out to be a mixed blessing.
Hey, so show is the Barracudas.
Dr. Appleton.
I remember auditioning for things or not being able to get into things because they were convinced that I was that guy. A casting director said, I don't want to see anyone from Saturday Night Fever. And, you know, I just wouldn't take no for an answer. So I literally burst in to his office and I said, why won't you see me? And he said, I love your work. I said, you don't know my work. I said, you know Gus. I'm not Gus, okay? I want you to see my work. And he just wouldn't do it.
We became so identified to those characters that they didn't want to put you in another film because you were Joey in Saturday Night Fever, and it would take away from you becoming that other character.
Saturday Night Fever would become an especially touchy subject for Nick Cohn, the writer who penned the original article on which the film was based.
Before the article proper even begins, all of this stuff is factual.
It said something that my pictures were made up, but the story was true, where in fact, if anything was really true to the club, it was my pictures, you know?
In 1997, Cohn admitted to fabricating the majority of the article, including the character of Vincent, the inspiration for King of the Dance Floor, Tony Manero. But lovers of Saturday Night Fever will always be truly grateful for Cohn's imagination.
Nick Cohn made a lot of this stuff up, and Nick Cohn has later admitted. And I think it's all quite delightful.
Saturday Night Fever would ultimately prove to be a film that would outlast its dated elements and stands today not only as a record of a place in time, but a universal story that transcends time.
I think this film comments on the era. Here was a meeting ground where people felt there was an honest-to-God escape from their lives. And I think if you take the dancing away, you still have a film that has a message or a meaning about just the human condition.
Every time it comes on, I'm fixed, and I made the thing, I shot it. And every time I watch it, I see something different that I hadn't seen before. And you know, a couple of lines I may have missed, or a couple of nuances. But it's amazing that every time I watch that film, something comes out of it that I hadn't seen before.
When you have as many people come up to you as I have that say how much this movie meant to them, it was a seminal moment in their life. They can tell you exactly where they were when they saw this movie. They can tell you exactly the effect it had on them. And it's not just the music. It's not just that they went out and bought a white suit. It's about something in their life that fundamentally was impacted by Saturday Night Fever.
Over 30 years later, Saturday Night Fever's journey has taken it from trendy to camp to classic.
It seemed like it was a kind of a pinnacle that couldn't be competed with. Do you know what I mean? It seemed like it doesn't quite get bigger than that.
It was magic every day that the movie was filming and every day after it when I, you know, got closer to seeing the first cut of the picture. And I've never had that close of a vantage point again of seeing somebody become a star in front of your very eyes. I couldn't wait for every day to start, and, you know, I wanted to be the first one there and the last one that left at night, and it's a pretty amazing experience. You know, it's one that I treasure.
We were such a bunch of, you know, kids that suddenly had a movie to make. I was so blessed because everyone on this film wanted this to be great. Everyone wanted this to be wonderful, and for artistic reasons.
You know, it was a very collaborative effort. Everybody involved with the film was very special, I think. And it was just that incredible combination of people.
We were a family on that film. That we created a world, and that world was so strong and so united that people were drawn to it. To this day, I don't think they realize that film's gonna live longer than we're gonna live.
We'll always share this bond of this one experience. You know, this is gonna bond us for life. We'll take this to the grave, you know, literally.
Just be friends, right? We'll just be friends.